Amen. Well, if you're wondering and you're curious, I'm dressed like Jack Hanna for the kids today for the second service. So we're still going to have fun with them today because second service is when we finish up our BBS and go over, and the kids is going to perform for us. And Clark Cavern is going to come back and encourage the kids to stay on their walk. Amen? Yes, amen. So if you have children, stay back for the second service because that's when they will do all of their skits and their performing and show you what they have learned. Amen? Amen. Well, I'm excited to be here this morning. Amen. And I don't know why that slides always kind of mess up when I put them together. They never seem to look the same way here. But anyway, you get the point. It's all coming together. So, Father, as we come before you today, God, I thank you and I praise you for the opportunity to come before you one more time, God, and preach your word. Father, I pray, God, that the anointing, God, will fall upon me, God, and the words that I say and that I speak, God, will be clear and precise. And Father, that they will enter our hearts, God, and Lord, that they will come back to our remembrance, God, and destroy the yokes that cause us to have a greater relationship with you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, amen. Well, also, I want to make a mention that we are starting our fundraisers for our trip in India. And so we are putting together a team, a ministry team. And I've been asked to go and teach a conference to several pastors over in India. So we're going to start working and driving to raise the money to get there. Amen? Amen. Amen. And we already support Brother Thomas's orphanage over there, so and some of his other works. So, but anyway, that will be coming up in October, the 1st of October when we leave. So, but there's many different things that we're going to be doing to drive and raise the money. So anything that you do and participate in, it will be greatly appreciated. Amen. We're going to Ecclesiastes 3:1 today. You know, Ecclesiastes is usually one of them scriptures or one of these just chapters that you hear a lot in funerals, especially on TV, stuff like that. But God has given me a different direction for that today. Amen? When everybody's there, say amen. Amen. All right. To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. Go ahead and be reseated today. You know, the one thing that I wanted to show on that first slide was the ecosystem. Was, you know, how everything fits together. God has a perfect plan and a design for everything in the universe. Can I get a witness? Amen. Do we believe that? Yes, amen. And so, you know, and as I was preparing this, there was a story that I had heard and had read and some time back. And some of you may remember. But some time back at Yellowstone National Park, there became an epidemic. There was infestation with wolves. There was wolves everywhere. And they were getting out of control. And everybody was complaining because they felt like they couldn't enjoy the national park and the forest and all that it had to work or all that it had to offer for the danger of all of the wild wolves that were around. Wild wolves were starting to come up and get amongst campers and people searching for food and stuff like that. And so there was a huge outcry for the government to do something with the wolves. Fix the wolf problem. So, what does our government do? They sit down, they put a team of people together, and they make a plan to fix the wolf problem. And so that's exactly what they did. There was hundreds and hundreds of wolves that was shot, trapped, or transferred to other places. And that were scooped up and put to other locations. And after a while, they looked back and they said, "Woo!" They held the whole program. It was a success. Everything was running smoothly at Yellowstone once again. People felt safe. Everybody were happy. The wolf population was once under control. And so the program was held a huge success. Well, a few years later, there was a deer infestation. And there were deer everywhere. There was deer that was becoming a danger to vehicles and to drivers all over the place. Everywhere. People could not make simple trips and drive in simple areas without having the fear of having deer being run over. Not them running over deer, but deer running over them and damaging vehicles or threatening their lives by trying to swerve. I mean, it's a natural instinct. Deer dump out in the road, what do? You hit the ditch. You know, and so you know, after a while, then the deer infestation started to grow and started to move out to the cities and to the surrounding towns. They were getting into the crops and into the fields all around. And so farmers were losing their fields and their crops that they were growing. And people in neighborhoods were being infested by deer everywhere. And once again, people started crying out for all of the problems with the deer. And then they turned around and they blamed the government for the infestation of the deer for removing the wolves in the first place. So, I mean, you know, the reason that I tell this story is because there is a plan and a purpose and a design for everything that God has created in the universe. And sometimes we don't understand it. Sometimes we look at our lives and we're lost because it looks like there's an infestation of wolves in our lives. Amen? There looks like there's an infestation, and everywhere we go, there is danger and there's wolves everywhere that is taunting us. And then we start praying to God, "God, remove the wolves from my life. God, take care of the wolves that are in my life, that's threatening everything in my life, threatening all the peace, all the calmness, all of my security. Remove the wolves in my life. Bring balance back to me, God." How many of us have been there? You know, we've done that before. I've done that before in my life where I have, you know, cried out, God has turned down the heat a little bit. I know this has to be an attack from the enemy because this pot's way too hot for it to be you, God. Amen? Yeah. You know, God says that He would refine us with fire. Skimming out and pulling out the impurities in our life. And yet, when we see this and we experience this, the first thing that we do is say, "God, take care of the wolf problem in my life. There's too many wolves in my life right now." Well, I want to tell you something. There may be a reason why the wolves were there. See, the wolves were there controlling the deer population, which was a great better danger to the actual public than what the wolves were. You know, sometimes we start praying things out of our lives that needs to be there, that needs to be working in our lives. You know, when the wolves are after us, I promise you, you'll stay focused on God and you'll keep your eye on Him and keep it running towards Him a lot better than you will when you got a whole bunch of infestation of just aggravating deers. Yeah? If you just got some little aggravating deers in your life, you're not going to be near as in tune with God as if you ain't got some wild wolves just running up your backside chasing you with all that you have. Sometimes we don't understand things, but God does have a plan and a purpose for everything in this world. Everything in this universe. And see, this whole ecosystem is perfectly designed by a master designer. We look at floods as a tragedy in our lives. You know, we have seen, like, you know, we've seen the Mississippi River flood numerous times in Illinois, and all around would just be, it'd be devastating. We've seen floods in this area that were devastating. Homes lost. We've seen people lost in high waters and flood waters. And we tag them as natural disasters and catastrophes and tragedies. But I want to tell you something. Them floods that God has designed is what brings back nourishment and minerals to the soil that allows us to still grow and bring forth food for us. But yet we turn around and we look at a tragedy of a flood being just that. Instead of just saying, you know, instead of us working around what God has designed, we're trying to control what God has designed, and then we call it a catastrophe in our life. We call everything global warming. We call all of these things, and oh, we got to do something. We got to fix the ecosystem because something's wrong. Well, how do we know something's wrong? Have we been here since eternity? Have we been here since the beginning of time with God when He created the whole thing and designed it to work together? There may be a reason that things are melting and replenishing the soil and running off. There may be reasons that the seasons and the cycles change and they alternate. Right? But we look at them as tragedy. Instead of embracing and becoming a part of God's design and His plan. But see, you know that the floodwaters that come in, they re-nourish the ground, and the ground, it gets the strength to bring forth more plants and more trees, which we all know that plants and trees does what? Takes the carbon dioxide that we expel out of ourselves. It takes it, feeds on it, and replenishes what? Oxygen, the very thing that we need in our life. God has not left one thing out of this design out of kilter. We look at the clouds and we look at the skies. And if Jenna was in here, me and her was out there yesterday looking at clouds and skies. We was looking at all the pictures in the sky that God had painted for us up there. And how that they looked and how they take shape and make things in there. And yes, the clouds are beautiful and they make shapes and they change and stuff like that. And everything, and it's beautiful to look at. But see, them clouds were designed for more than just looking at and to be pretty in the sky. Them clouds protect us from harmful UV rays that would otherwise burn us up in our tender skin. Them clouds also carry moisture in them that goes from one location to the next location that replenishes rain that we need for life. God has not left one thing undone in His design. But yet we see ourselves fighting and struggling against it. You know, in Ecclesiastes 3 and 1 that we just read, it says, to everything there is a season and a time and every purpose under earth. Well, I'm just going to ask you, are you under heaven? Are you under heaven today? Because it said that there is a perfect purpose for everything that is under the heaven. So I'm just going to ask you today, can you wrap your mind around it? Are you under the heaven? Are you under God's universe? Are you here today? Because if you are, that means that God has a perfect plan and a perfect purpose for you. If He has designed the whole universe to exist with each other in perfect harmony, then that means that you are part of His universe and He has planned perfectly for you and your life, a plan and a purpose for you. You are not here by accident. God means for you to be here. God means for you to be on this earth. There is no accident in your life that you are here. If you're struggling with your existence, wondering what you're to do, and stuff, and with with your life, then seek God, because He has a perfect plan for you. He has a perfect purpose for you in your life. If you're underneath His universe, then you are meant to be here, and you have a plan, and you're a part of His master design. The one thing the enemy wants to do is try to convince us that we are worthless and that we're no good and we don't fit in anywhere. But I'm going to tell you something. By the blood of Jesus Christ, you fit into the kingdom of God and you fit into His perfect plan that He has master designed. Every one of us has a calling and a purpose in our life. Every single one of us. There's people out there that Bill can reach and minister to that I cannot. And God knew that, so He designed Bill to be able to work that area. Every one of us has a way. I have seen some people come in and they would work with kids and they would be able to identify and touch them. And then another worker, it'd be just like talking to a brick wall. That's because God designed that person and their personality to reach that other group, that other child. We all have a plan in our lives. But yet, we're all busy worried about the wolves in our lives, trying to run from the wolves rather than saying, God, show me my plan. Show me the design that You have for me. And God, help me fulfill me in my life. Instead, we're praying for the tragedies and the wolves to leave us. Instead of embracing what God has got for us. We see that this world is full of all different kind of religions. You know, when I was studying the Roman era, about the time in the Roman Empire, at the time of Jesus Christ, there was 3,000 known religions at that time. 3,000 known religions in the Roman Empire at that time. And there is hundreds of thousands of religions to this day. Or so-called religions. Why? Because God has designed us with a spot in our lives for Him. And every one of us are out there looking to feel that whether we know it or not. And the devil is coming in with false religions and false doctrines and false teachings of all different kinds and putting it out there so we will look on it and grab a hold of it to try to fill a spot that only God should be in. Where do you think this Scientology and all of these other things come in? It sounds good. It feels good. So that must be the spot that I need to plug it in. And the whole time, the devil is out there setting a trap, running us with wolves into these false areas in our lives to get us off track. And why is he doing that? So we will not fit into God's design. Purpose that he has for us. If we are plugged into something that is false or dead or should not be, then God cannot work in our lives to that effect. If we're plugged into some kind of false doctrine or teaching or religion or some kind of occult practice, then God cannot use us. And the enemy was successful getting in our minds and drawing us away and getting us off track and taking us out of God's design. What God has really called us for, to love people as He loved people, to work in people as He has worked in people. We are truly God's hands and feet, and we are His mouthpiece. We are His spokesperson, and the devil is trying everything that he can on this earth to get you unplugged and put you somewhere else by lying to you, telling you that you're worthless and you're no good, or you don't fit, or there's no plan for you in your life. He's even told you that you've gone too far and you've done too many things to fit into God's plan anymore. And we continue to look and search in our lives. We look in money. We look in jobs. We look in relationships to try to fill that hole in our lives. But no matter what we do, the only thing that's going to truly bring us joy and peace in our life is plugging in to God's perfect plan for us in our life. Proverbs 29 and 18, it says, "Where there is no vision, my people perish. But to he that keepeth the law, happy is he." What we're talking about there is he that keepeth the law, he that stays on track, he that keeps a running after God and not worried about the wolves in their life, he that keeps his eye on Jesus Christ, he is blessed above all others. It doesn't matter. When we do that, God in life, a vision in our life. The word vision there in the Hebrew is kazon. And kazon literally means to see with your mind's eye. It means to have a clear daydream or a revelation. Now revelation, when you see that, and the word revelation there that you look at in the Greek, it means to suddenly appear out of the dark. And you can clearly see it. That's what God wants to do in your life. If He wants to enlighten you and bring your plan that He has for you to light, He wants to bring it right in front of you so where you, when you close your eyes, you can clearly see what God has planned for you and called for you. You can clearly see it in your mind's eye. Some of us know what that purpose and plan is. And some of us are still running and trying to find it. But the thing is that we see here is that if we're running in wrong directions, we'll never be able to close our eyes and see what God has truly enlightened us. I can remember it was about 20-something years ago. I rededicated my heart and my life back to Jesus Christ. And it wasn't about a year or two after that, God started ministering to me on a ministry. Now, I was way too young to be in the calling that God had shown me and God was working in my life. But God was giving me that. There was promises that God had made to me in my life at that point. And at that point, all I had to do was just start running towards Him and not worrying about anything in my life. I'm going to tell you, there's been some wolves in my life chewing on my heels numerous times in my life trying to run me off course. But I just keep my eyes put on Jesus Christ, knowing and trusting that one day that He would do something in my life as He promised. He attacked my career. In my work, He's attacked my family. He attacked my finances. There was everywhere that the enemy could work in my life. At one time or another, he has attacked and has chewed on a little bit. But I just had to stay with that vision that I seen in my mind. Now the thing is I didn't know what the end vision looked like. I just knew that God had a plan and I just had to keep going at it. And the longer that I ran, the more clear that it became. The longer that I ran, the closer that it got to me and the better that I could see it. You know, when you look out and you're driving on a straight desert road way up ahead of you, you can't really see nothing. It just looks like a V in the road up there. But the closer and the longer that you drive toward it, the more that it starts to pop out and become clear. That's the way in our lives. The longer that we run this thing with Jesus Christ, the more clear that the purpose and plan becomes in our lives. But we get on here and we want to have a vision that God has given us, and we want it today without preparing and changing anything in our life. That's where the devil has mastered the ability to work in our lives and get us off track. We think that by simply giving our heart to God, that everything should fall into place in our life. And when it don't, then it's somebody else's problem or somebody else's fault. It's not ours for keeping our eye on the road, running diligently down that road that God has called us, and not worried about anything else but just Jesus Christ. It ain't God's fault that you're off track. It ain't man's fault that you're off track. It's your fault for letting things run you and drive you off the track that God has put you on in your life. If you want to fulfill God's plan and destiny that He has for you, then you run with all your might and all your ability towards Jesus Christ Himself. The devil wants you to believe that it's everyone else's fault or everyone else's doing, but it's your own doing for getting your eyes off of Jesus Christ when He has called you to do something in your life. He has masterly planned and has designed with His master designing skills, and it has erected the perfect structure for you in your life. And the only time that you're ever going to be able to achieve it is when you work towards it. 2 Peter 1:10 says, "Wherefore, we rather, brethren, give diligence to make our calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, you shall never fail." Fall. That word diligence is spadazzo. Spadazzo means to make haste, to labor, to study diligently, to apply yourself with all of your efforts. Are you applying yourself with 100% of your efforts today? Are you just laying around looking at the wounds that the wolves have brought into your life? You know, God has done miraculous things in your life to even get you this far. And God is working in your life right now. But you need to pour out 100% of your own effort that God has given you. Every strength, every ounce. And say, "God, I am here. I'm running for You and only You in my life. I will fulfill the calling that You have placed on my life, whatever it may be." All that Jesus Christ is looking for is a yes or no answer. That's all He's looking for is a yes or no answer. We need to be running with all of our might. Ephesians 2:10. "For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained." Before He created the universe, in Ephesians 1:4, He said that He knew you before the foundation of the world. He knew you before He scattered the stars into the universe. He knew every wolf that would be chasing you. He knew every trouble that you would face. He knew every heartache that you would be in. He knew everything in your life right then. He had created you to a good work. Sometimes we think, and we struggle. But right here, He says, you are His workmanship. You are part of His master design in His life. You can either let the devil run you off track, or you can grab a hold of what God is trying to do in your life and let the wolves chase some things out of you. We look here. I'm putting an anchor to this thing. We're dragging this thing to a close. God has created you to do bigger things in Christ Jesus. We can look at it and say that right there. He has created you, and His workmanship created you in Christ Jesus. So what that is actually saying, He has created you to do big things in Christ Jesus. Not do big things in yourself, but to do big things in Christ Jesus. We will never be nothing. See, the devil is telling you a half-truth. Because you are nothing. And you'll always be nothing in your own. But you will always be everything to God through Christ Jesus. You will always have a purpose and a plan and a perfect desire in Christ Jesus. When you step out of Christ Jesus, yes, the devil is right. You are worthless and no good. But I'm going to tell you, you can slay giants in your life through Christ Jesus. You can tromp over mountains through Christ Jesus. You can swim the deepest seas through Christ Jesus. But everything in it is in Christ Jesus. It all is wrapped up in Christ Jesus and the work that He is working in your life. How many of us are tired of struggling? How many of us are tired of fighting? How many of us just feel like that every day is a struggle? That I'm going to tell you, sometimes it's because we're fighting against the master design that God has. God loves you too much to leave you right where you're at. God is still working in your life. And yes, some of them wounds God has led and allowed in your life to try to trace you back on track. Because God loves you too much for you to stay right where you're at. We see in Romans 8:28, we know that all things, we know is I do. And it means to perceive and to understand with full understanding. Do we really believe sometimes that God is working everything out in our life for our good? Do we really understand that? Do we really perceive that with our mind? Do we grab a hold of what God is trying to do in our lives and just put ourselves into a position and say, I don't understand, God, but I know that You're a master designer, and if I have to walk blindly, I'm going to keep walking blindly because I know, God, that You work all things out. Pos in the Greek. All. I'm telling you, that was one of my first Greek words that I learned, and that just so excited me when I seen that. Because I just looked at that word just all in English, but when I studied it out and I seen what it really meant, it became alive to me. Anything, everything, including all, excluding nothing, God works out in your life. That means that nowhere, no matter what I'm facing in my life, no matter what kind of wrong turns or bad decisions in my life, God loves me so much that He's going to turn it all around and work it out for the good in my life if I would just keep my eyes focused on Him. You know, I've made some horrible decisions in my life. And I have ran my boat and my bus off into the ditch numerous times. And I've hung all four wheels of this bus up in the ditch. And I didn't know how to get out of it. But God has been faithful. That when I look and I call upon Him, even in my wrong decisions, even in my wrong duty, He loved me and worked in my life to get me back on track. Why? Because I'm a part of His master design. I have a reason for existence. And if all of us really want to get down to it, we all just want to know that we fit and we belong. We can put on a tough man attitude, or we can put in a stone, coney heart, but when it boils down to it, we just want to know that we matter in our lives, right? And God is saying right here, you matter in His design. He has a plan and a purpose for you. And I don't care how many times the devil has told you, you have wrecked it and you'll never be able to fix it. God loves you and He's turning it around in your life if you'll just let Him work in your life today. Last week we were preaching, just what if you say yes? What if you just say yes today? What if we just say yes? The last thing I want to bring out is the word there, purpose. It is prothesis. Prothesis in the Greek. And what this actually, well, I'll read the definition to you. To set before or place in front of you. Now this Greek word has a meaning here, and we're going to go somewhere with this. God does not make accidents when He puts something in the Word of God. Amen? To set up with a purpose. But this word is directly linked back to the Hebrew meaning of showbread. When you look at this word and you translate it back out, every dictionary that I went to, every concordance of Strong's, the lexicon, every one of them draw this word right here, right back to the Hebrew, meaning showbread. And the showbread was what? That they would come and the Israelites would prepare weekly. And they would go in on the last day of the week and they would add that showbread on the altar as an offering in the Holy of Holies for God. It had a purpose. It had a purpose. That was the food that we could go back in afterwards and share with God. That is the showbread that David asked of the priest to bring him to eat. God has a purpose for the things in your life. It's to set you up as a testimony in your life. Now, I'm not saying that we go through things in our lives so we can have a testimony. What I am saying, though, is that when we make wrong decisions in our life, God works it all out so we will have a testimony. God did not call you to the middle of the desert to die of thirst, but He called you to the middle of the desert so He may give you living water and rise you up for others to be fed with the water that He has put in you, running out of your belly, ever flowing out of you. God did not call you to the middle of the ocean to drown. But God, hey, you may be in the middle of the ocean right now, but God will call you to rise above the waters and walk on the waters if that's what you need to be to have a testimony in your life. There is a plan that is set out there and a view for others to view God's mercy and love and compassion in your life. You are God's showbread. You have a plan and a purpose in your life. God is calling you His showbread. We just have to get ourselves in sync to where we ain't worried about wolves or floods or deserts. Keep our eyes focused on Jesus. God knows that we have financial problems. God knows that we have relationship problems. God knows that we have work problems. God knows that we have all of these things in our lives. And if we will stay focused on Him today, He will bring everything into part of His master design. Because the trouble you're facing today is the answer that you're seeking for tomorrow. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Yes, Jesus. Father, as we come before You today, God. Father, I pray, God, that You will prick our hearts, God. And that You'll let the anointing, God, start seeping into our lives right now, God, of the Word. God, that it will start to work out in our lives and in our hearts, God. Lord, let our minds be able to comprehend and receive this today, God. Lord, I pray a hedge of protection over this world, God, that the enemy cannot steal. Because God, You love. You love us so much that You gave everything that You have for us. That we may be the light of the life of You.